Indeed, today I'm going to talk about distribution of mobile games beyond the app stores. Well, actually also a little bit about the app stores, but primarily beyond the app stores, and primarily about social gaming, mobile social gaming beyond the app stores. Two things important. First of all, how can you distribute actually your games in a different way apart from the app stores? And secondly, if you are in the games development business, how can you smartly develop your games in a way that you can distribute it amongst as many platforms as possible without having to recode your games over and over again? We found a sort of, well, solution for it, or at least a method. We'll go into that. But maybe first, very short, an introduction of Booster Media. I think a lot of you probably don't know the company. So I'm happy to very briefly tell you who we are and what we do. And I would like to, if we have enough time, end up with some questions, discussion from all of you. So please come forward if you have any questions in the end. Now we'll go into it. Okay, so who is Booster Media? Booster Media is a young company. We're 2.5 years old. We are based near Amsterdam. We have around 25 people, growing very rapidly. And our primary business is actually in the games distribution field. So we distribute games, mobile games, internationally, primarily through the open mobile web. Also a little bit through app stores, but primarily through the open mobile web. We don't do that alone. We actually do that together with partners. And our partners are primarily media companies, social networks, and game companies, game websites, I should say. Those three types of groups have been dominating the online casual and now social gaming space in the last 10 years. But also, these groups are struggling in a way how to go to mobile. Yes, obviously, many of them have been launching iPhone apps, but there's a whole world beyond the iPhone apps. So we have partners now in, well, primarily in Europe, where we started, but actually now growing very rapidly in South America and Asia. And I'll give you some examples later on. Finally, we also have our in-house game studio. When we started 2.5 years ago, there were no browser-based mobile games available. They were just not there. So sort of we started to build them ourselves. And we became, I think, quite good at it. So we now have a whole team building browser-based mobile games. That's it about Booster. Maybe first question, why should we use the open mobile web anyway? I mean, we have the app stores, right? Well, for me it's clear, but maybe I can show you this example. This is a screenshot I made from the iPhone app store. It's a Dutch version, but you can probably see the same screenshot in any other version of iTunes. I took this 1 or 2 months ago, and I think the top 20 was dominated by Rovio and a couple of other big players, which is obviously great for Rovio and for companies who have good games. But there are a few hundred thousand other games in there. How can you find them? And it shows. This recently came out, a research to how actually games monetize in the iPhone App Store. A few games make a lot of money. No doubt about that. There are some games that make a nice, decent amount of money, but a lot of games don't make any or hardly any money. That's why I say one of the reasons to look a little bit further than just the App Stores. App Stores is great. But there are other ways of distributing your games as well. So how would it work? If we partner up with our partners, media companies again, game websites, social networks, we always work from the browser. If someone types in a game website in its browser on a mobile phone, or comes through that through Google Mobile or another another search engine, then actually we detect if it's either a mobile phone or a tablet, or a PC. If it's a mobile phone, we lead them automatically to a mobile optimized game portal. When we started this 2.5 years ago, we actually had a mobile game portal, so not the iPhone App Store. But the games in there were iPhone apps, and iPhone apps can only be downloaded from iTunes. So in the end, we still had to lead the clients to the iTunes App Store, which is not an ideal experience. If you're used to play games on the web, you play a game, if you stop it, you're back in the game portal again, in the branded experience. So that's where browser-based games come in. In the case of iPhone, obviously it's HTML5, You play a game directly from your portal. If you quit the game, you're back into the portal, in the game's destination, your branded experience. You don't have to lead someone to the iPhone App Store. You can keep them under your own control. So how would it work for other platforms? Well, we have solved that for actually all mobile platforms. And where possible, we have a combination of browser-based technologies. Everybody's talking about HTML5, which is great. Certainly one of the solutions for the future. But it's not the only solution at the moment. You can also use Flash, mobile optimized Flash, on Android, for example. Most Androids have Flash built in. But don't even forget about feature phones. Still a lot of markets, and we see that, for example, in our own markets. In Brazil, 80% of the phones is still kind of Nokia phone, Samsung phone. And yes, they also support browser-based games. They support Flash Lite. It's a very old technology, not a lot of people know about it, but you can make great casual games in that. Not social, but casual. And obviously, you still have a lot of phones who don't support one of these. You see BlackBerry has been a little bit behind in this case. Not really good support for HTML5 in the browsers. It's improving. They're getting there. Windows Phone 7, first releases. Not really good in HTML5, but it will come there. So step by step, you will see all platforms able to play any form of browser-based gaming. So how would that look then? This is an example of one of our partners, Yuda Games. I'm sure many of you are familiar with Yuda Games. So we've built a mobile portal for Yuda Games. You go to yudagames.com, you end up in the mobile portal on your phone, and you see a game that you like, you say play, maybe you see some additional information, high scores for example, some information about the game, screenshots, and if you then say I like the game, it starts automatically. You can do this with both HTML5, Mobile Flash, Flash Lite. If you quit, you're back into the portal again. So you don't lose a customer, he's not going away to somewhere else. One of the things that may be good to mention also after the remark of this morning about PlayStation, in a number of markets at this stage, we see that PlayStation is the number three platform visiting our mobile portals. Obviously iPhone is still number one in most Western markets, Android is number two. But PlayStation, for example, in France or in Germany, in France or in Spain, is very big. There has been a browser on PlayStation already for many years, and we see a lot of people actually looking for free games from their PlayStation Portable. I'm talking about PlayStation Portable here. So it's still an important platform and one of the platforms we consider. So we now have released over 50 game portals in about 20 countries, different languages. And we actually learn a lot of things about this. For example, we see that user behavior from people with an iPhone is different from visitors having an Android phone. Certainly different from people with a feature phone. One of the things that we found out is that iPhone users are the most spoiled users because they have a great iPhone App Store. They have great iPhone games, native games already for many years. And the first generation of HTML5 games has been, well, not at the same level of native games. So we saw, for example, the time spent from iPhone users a little bit lower than users from an Android phone or users with a feature phone. But you see it's going up now. HTML5 is getting better. The kind of games are getting better. There's more games available in the market than one or 1.5 years ago. So we try to learn from all the different platforms how we can optimize the browser-based portal experience. Maybe to put the browser-based portals next to the app stores. Again, I'm not saying that one is better than the other. I'm just saying there's an alternative. I won't go into all the details here, but I think a couple of things here that I want to take out. If you put your games in the iPhone App Store, you have one big benefit, or actually you have two very big benefits over the open mobile web. In an app store, you immediately have millions of visitors. If you go to the put your game in the iTunes App Store, you have tens of millions of visitors directly available. If you do it in the open mobile web, somehow you have to get traffic yourself. There are a lot of ways of doing that, but you have to start from scratch usually. And in the iPhone App Store, it's already available. But on the other hand, there's also a lot of competition in the iPhone App Store. If you have your own destination, you can determine yourself what games do you put in there. How does it look like? How does the branding look like? For example, the branded experience in the iPhone App Store, all the games more or less look the same. They all have the same gray pages, same sort of screenshots. If you make your own destination, you can perfectly decide upon yourself how it should look like. How should the destination, the branded experience look like? Maybe more important, at least from my perspective, if you have your own mobile browser-based destination, you own your customers. In the case of iPhone App Store or Android App Store or any other App Store, you can see the number of downloads, you can see the number of transactions, but you don't really see where the people are coming from, how they get there, who they are. If you have your own web-based environment, all the things that you are used to from the web are sort of more or less available as well. Finally, in the open mobile web, you can determine your own business model. You don't necessarily have to play by the rules of the App Store that's dictated. You can say, okay, this is the business model for my game. This is the business model for my portal. You can decide it on, yourself. Clearly, in one thing, at the moment still, especially iPhone App Store, excels, and that's in billing. If you look at premium downloads, or even more important, at if you look at freemium model, where you actually buy a virtual good within the game, iPhone is absolutely the best at the moment. Off-portal or open web mobile billing, it's still in its infancy. There are a lot of solutions coming out there, and yes, you can use credit cards and you can use PayPal. A lot of users probably won't type in all their details in a mobile portal they don't know, or they don't trust, or they see it for the first time. So you have to find other solutions. We're working on that, and a lot of other companies are working on that. But still, that's not as advanced as the iPhone App Store. And in most cases, you probably have to find a solution in different markets. So a billing solution in Brazil might be different than a billing solution in Germany or the US. So there you see still some differences and some advantage of the app stores over the open mobile web. So let's go social. This is an example of one of our own first social games, browser-based. We launched this a few months ago. And the last 3-4 months, we really have been beta testing this game. We start with smartphones. And from that, actually, we also make tablet versions, HD, and full web versions. And we try to learn how users actually behave in this. I mean, it's not a native app. It's a browser-based game. How do they behave in it? How does the game work? How does it compare to native games that they're maybe used to? We learned a lot of things from this. And let me show you how the user flow works. Again, an example of one of the game portals. It can be any portal. I see a nice game I like. In this case is Jewel Club, social game. I click on it. And then it opens. And you see it, a browser page. In this case, the technology being used is Flash. Flash 10.1. So it only works on high-end Androids. But it comes closest to the native environment that most users are used to. So, then how does it work? Well, actually, we ask people to log in with their Facebook account. Or they can choose to play anonymously. Obviously, we want them to log in because then we can see much more. And we use Facebook Connect for that. Facebook Connect is a great system to keep track of users, usernames, achievements, performance, credits, coins, friends. And actually, the good thing about it is this is not on Facebook. These games sit in the open mobile web. They sit in this portal. But they use Facebook Connect just as a reference for the high score lists, the scores, the coins, etc. Of course, the scores and the coins are all on our server side. But Facebook Connect is the one to measure. Instead of Facebook Connect, obviously, there can be other social networks to be used there. But Facebook Connect is a good way to start. And again, this is not on Facebook. This is off Facebook. However, we found out when we launched this game in the first instance, a few months ago, that a lot of users don't log in through Facebook Connect. And we have an anonymous version for them. If you play the anonymous version, you don't see who your friends are, because we don't know who you are. So we also don't know who your friends are. you really don't can help build up coins and bring them to the next level. So it has a lot of limitations. And we saw in the first instance that about 20% of people the first time logged in through Facebook, Facebook Connect. So one of the things that we're doing now is really trying to get it up, to get the number of people logging in to Facebook Connect or any other social infrastructure higher than that number. One of the solutions, well, one of the things we're working on is detect if someone is already logged in into Facebook on his mobile phone through the app or mobile web. And if he's already logged in, we skip the whole login phase. Another solution is actually to start the game directly, but only when you have a social feature coming into play, only then we ask to log in so that they're already playing. Try to get them in the game. And again, all these things have to be sort of found out. I mean, these are not native apps. They're not hundreds of examples how you should do it, and we really are trying to get the user involved, get him returning, and get him to log in. If he logs in, he usually stays longer. We give him presents, like most social games. The more days he spends in a row, the more coins he gets. The good thing is that the people who actually did log in the game play a very long time. And again, it's a browser-based game, but they play around 20 minutes per game session in a browser-based game for this one single game. And it's apart from playing other games, it's apart from the browser. And most people who see it actually feel like it's a native environment. But again, the process towards that's a challenge. So if you look at mobile, beyond the app stores, you're looking at a fragmented market. You look at a lot of different solutions, a lot of different platforms, a lot of different technologies. So that's why we came up with a sort of what we call smart development process. Try to keep the number of code bases limited and still have the output to many different platforms as high as possible. At the moment for us, it's two technologies. It's Flash, mobile Flash, I have to say. We never work from web Flash. We really start from mobile, having learned about CPU power, having learned about interface. So we're not converting web games from Flash to mobile, but we start from scratch with a mobile interface. And it's HTML5. This is the combination that really works for us with a lot of output to different platforms. I'll give you all of them in a minute. I think in a year from now, this picture probably will be a little bit different. I think HTML5 will be at least at the same level as Flash, and maybe even more. There's still some limitations why Flash is so important for us today. Well, first of all, we're in the browser-based gaming business, so we want to have a browser-based version available. And with mobile Flash, if you design it well, and if you test it on your mobile phone, that's perfectly doable, especially for Android. For iOS, obviously, we need HTML5. No Flash allowed. But we can do a lot more than this. Flash is also perfectly suitable for doing some fast prototyping. Just testing some game. How does it work? Is it a good user flow? Do people actually like it? Flash is perfect for that. We develop about 3 times as fast in Flash as in HTML5. So for prototyping, perfect. But then the good thing also is that from Flash, actually, you can make apps. And they behave like native apps using Android Air. And an increasing number of platforms at the moment is supporting Android Air. You sort of save your Flash file in a little bit different way. You have to adjust a few things, but not a lot. And you can save it as a native app. And a user don't even know that it originally has been Flash. It's just an app for him. So we have now some first games in the Android market, just as a native downloadable game. And we are, as we speak, are uploading them to all sorts of other Android markets and other Android stores through Android Air. And still, there are sort of lower-end smartphones. Bada and Ovi. The latest releases of Ovi, Nokia phones, actually also support Flash. But they support Flash Lite 4.0. A lot of people don't know that. It's very close to Flash 10.1. A little bit different, so you have to adjust it a little bit. But again, there you can use your existing code base for other platforms. But there's more. One of the solutions also is to make a hybrid app for iOS. So you make a little small native app, and in the native app you open a web view. And in the web view you display your HTML5 game. And that way you can put it in the App Store. One alternative is actually also that you use Flash Builder and make a native app of that. But there's still some limitations. So it doesn't work for us, but it might work for some other game developers. And finally, the good thing of working with these two code bases is that you actually also can go to the full web, either a Facebook game or just a web game that sits on any game portal or game site. So with two code bases, we can use all these different platforms without having to know all the different native technologies in the market. Again, this picture will change a little bit in the next year, but for now, this really works for us. I thought about fragmentation. I mean, the mobile market is very fragmented. There's some very big audiences, like, again, in the app stores. That's what still people know at the moment. But there are a lot of other ways to distribute your mobile games. By using these two code bases and all these different platforms, we can actually distribute through open mobile web. Here are some examples where we are distributing our games. These are our own portals or through mobile Facebook. Or actually through the app stores. So with two code bases, again, we can actually reach a whole lot of users in different places. Social games. I think social games require a little bit of extra attention, especially when it comes to browser-based gaming and not native. A few things I would like to share where you maybe should look at when you develop these yourself. I talked about code bases, so I won't go into that anymore. I think it's very useful to make a prototype first. For example, in Flash, but there are also other tools available where you can test your game so that you know really how it looks like and then actually start building the HTML5 version. If you make the HTML5 version and you know exactly what the behavior should be, how the screen should look like, then the HTML5 development process is much faster than if you start from paper or from screen. Of course, there are some limitations to browser-based gaming at the moment. It's perfect for 2D gaming, it's perfect for social, for most casual games, but it's not really good at the moment for 3D gaming. It is changing. There are some technologies coming where you can do even 3D gaming in Flash or HTML5, but at the moment, it's certainly not good enough as native. And also, there are some limitations in sound, for example. If you look at HTML5 and on iOS, you cannot play two sounds at the same time. You can either have music or you have sound. So this is a different way of thinking. But again, if you're in casual space or in social space, usually it's more than enough. One other very big difference between a native game and a browser-based game is, of course, loading. A browser-based game, you should load every time you play the game. A native game, you download once, and maybe you only get some extra data, but sits already on your phone. Browser-based game, that's not the case. So one of the things we found out is actually that it's better to split the game up in a lot of different pieces, small pieces, instead of downloading the full game at once. For example, we do that with virtual items. We don't load all the virtual items within the game immediately, but first we download the framework of the game, and if the user is actually coming to an area in the game where he needs virtual items, then we download the virtual items. So build up your downloading. One of the last things I really want to emphasize here is analytics. It's all about data, 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 and I think we've heard that here over the last 2 days. And then probably on any other game event, when it's about social games, everybody will tell you it's about data. Well, you can do two things. You can build your own data tools to track everything, or you can use an existing tool. However, if you look at the existing tools on the market now, they're all built for Facebook web, full web, or they're built for native iPhone games. A real good tool that does everything you want in your browser-based game, we didn't find it. We checked about 10 different platforms and tools. In the end, we chose one which was the best. In our case, that was Contagion. But still, we need to do a lot of tricks and a lot of adjustments to make that tool work for us in a browser-based environment. It's not there yet. Also, these things will change. In 1 or 2 years from now, there will be much more tooling available. But for now, you have to be a little bit creative. Okay, so that's so far as sort of the tips I wanted to share with you on browser-based distribution and development. I want to finalize actually with one of our newest game releases, a little preview that we'll be releasing in the next few weeks, the first version. And that game will also be released in all the app stores and all the browser-based mobile versions and in the full web version based on the code bases I showed you. Let's first take one step back. These were the first casual browser-based game we developed in the last 2.5 years. These are really first-generation browser-based gaming. It's all the simple concepts you know from casual game sites, but it's not very high-end. It's nice, it's not very high-end. But they work also on feature phones, they work on smartphones, so it's a good start. These games are available both browser-based, and in some cases they're also available as downloadable apps in Ofi or in Bada from Samsung. And one of the things we found out by building around 50 of these games is that one particular category was by far the most popular category, both browser-based as well as in the app stores, and that was this one. You might be surprised. Girls games, dress-up games. This game, what you see here, is a very simple game. Actually, it's not even a game. It's a very simple dress-up game. It has been downloaded about 1.5 million times without any promotion. We really were surprised by that. So that started some thinking on our side. So what do we do with that? Apparently this is, you know, very popular category. What can we do there with social? And we came up with our next social game, which is Fashion Club. Fashion Club is fully browser-based, and it will be fully available in the app stores again. We'll be targeting girls and young women, roughly between, I would say, 12 and 24. Hardcore, we still have to see where that is. Yesterday I learned from Habbo, it's between 13 and 15. We have to see where it ends up here. We think it will be a little bit wider, but I think it's in a way similar to Habbo. Here's some screenshots of the social version. So when you start the game for the first time, you can make your own avatar. You make your own face, your hair, your skin color, and you start with start capital. You get some free coins, and you can start shopping. It's about shopping. It's about shopping and sharing. You start shopping in different shops, shopping area. Once you're done, you go to your dressing room, and you dress up. Very simple concept. You choose a background and some other additional information, and then you share that information on Facebook, or within the game, or in any other social network, or actually in the game portal itself. If you like a certain shared model, you give points, but also you give coins. So people who have a lot of friends get more coins, they earn more coins than others who don't. But, well, obviously we found a solution for that. You can buy extra coins and buy more clothes. This is something we have a lot of hope for. It's not live yet. We're beta testing it at the moment. But again, it will go live in the next months on different platforms. And it will be sharing across the different platforms. So if you log in one platform, you can see all your stuff you collected, all your coins, your achievements, your friends, your awards, because there's also all award system. And you can see that through the different platforms. Monetization, mobile advertising, and freemium model. Maybe at a later stage, we're talking to some fashion brands who also might be wanting to sponsor this. But we think this is the first browser-based mobile fashion game available. And all the lessons we learned over the last 2.5 years are put into this game. I'm exactly at 28 minutes. Are there any questions so far on distribution and development?
ton of information offered there, especially on hitting multiple platforms with just two code bases. I think that's a lot to be read into how you can be efficient in that way. Any questions for Lorenz? All right. Well, thank you very much.
I see one question.
Oh,
there.
Wait.
This is a very broad and general question, I guess, but how do you typically promote your browser-based games? I mean, is it just normal advertising spend within other mobile apps, or what's the usual process?
It's a very good question. Well, we're also in the distribution side, so we have about 50 branded portals that we control, and we do that obviously with our partners. But in most cases, we, together with our partners, we promote the games on those portals. So that's what we have in our own control. Then secondly, we find that because there's such a lack of browser-based games, and especially browser-based social games, I mean, there are hardly any available in the market, that a lot of other networks are really wanting to take these on board. And thirdly, we also see the same actually in app stores. That a lot of app stores really want to have a games like these. So it's a lot of business development work, and again, it's a fragmented market, but if you choose all the channels with relatively limited effort, because in the end, we are still 25 people company, you can do a lot of distribution promotion.
Yeah. I think we have time for one more.
Hello, I wanted to ask, what was Contagent missing that you needed? So you said it fits, but not so much, because it has a lot of features and...
Yeah. Okay, this is a very good question. It's also a little bit a technical question. So I really should refer to my tech guys who have been working on this and actually working on this as we speak. Contagent, let me be very clear. In our benchmark, and we looked at about 10 different platforms, it was by far the best for us. But then again, it didn't have all the things we needed. One of the difficulties is that the event-based tracking, so for example, what do people buy, when do they buy it, where do they coming from, it's all based on Facebook, so on one distribution platform. In our case, we have a lot of different distribution platforms. So it's more fragmented, and it's browser-based. And we run into some difficulties to do all the event-based tracking throughout the game. And we're not there yet at the moment, but literally every day we make a little step and measure more and more within the tool. I would say send me an email with your contact details and I can share some information just checking with the tech guys at home. I don't know all the technical insights there.
Thank you very much.